Go ahead and wave your hands real quick. Yeah, it's good for that. All right. Let me just share the link and then we're good to go.
Okay, cool.
Still behind schedule. Okay, so that's sent, and then I'll put on Facebook real quick, and then we're good to go. All right, I think we're good to go. We have two people watching so far.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, do you want me to shut the lights off?
Sure, it doesn't really matter.
Tonight we'll be covering the last of chapter 8. I wasn't actually here last time, so please let me know if I'm saying anything that doesn't make sense out of context. And the last topic in chapter 8 is just batch norm. After I do that, we'll move on to chapter 9, which is convolutional nets. Am I loud enough in the back? Can everybody hear me okay?
Yeah.
All right, thanks. Okay, so batch normalization is technically not an optimization algorithm. It's a way of designing your network that makes it easier to optimize. The basic idea is that a traditional convolutional network would have matrix multiplications where you've got a bunch of inputs in a matrix X, and you've got a bunch of parameters in a weight matrix W, and you multiply those together. And then usually you would pass those on to something like a rectified linear function. So batch norm says, rather than just doing this matrix multiplication, let's go ahead and apply a normalization step. And doing something that's a little bit unique for neural network architecture designs, it actually uses the entire batch to update each example individually. Most features that we see in neural network architectures update each example independently from all the others, so it can be parallelized across examples. So batch norm has two main steps. The first is to take the mean across the mini-batch for every feature in the mini-batch separately, and then to subtract that mean off of the activations that you have so far. That'll give you a new mini-batch of activations they'll call Z tilde. And in Z tilde, every feature has zero mean now. Then the next step is to compute the standard deviation of each of the features in the mini-batch. and then divide by the standard deviation. So now we have a mini batch where every feature has both zero mean and standard deviation one. We then go ahead and multiply by a parameter gamma and add a parameter beta. So it can have mean gamma and parameter beta. So it might seem a little bit silly that we go to all this effort to normalize the batch, and then we give it any mean and any standard deviation again. The reason we do this parameterization is that it gives us kind of a checkpointing system where every time we reach one of these z hat points in the network, right before the rectified linear activation over layer, we know that there's zero mean and unit standard deviation. And that'll happen regardless of the value of w, and it'll happen regardless of the value of the w's for the other layers that came earlier in the network. For other kinds of neural networks that don't have this periodic checkpointing where we get back to zero mean and unit standard deviation, every layer can affect the statistics of every layer that comes after it. For a batch norm, you only affect the higher order statistics, but the mean and the standard deviation stay the same at this checkpointed region all the time. And then at the very end of a batch normalized layer, we apply the rectified linear activation function, the same as we usually do. To give you an idea of what learning looks like with this kind of mechanism in place, we can step through two different scenarios. One where we look at a few different hidden layers updated with an SGD step, and then also what it looks like without batch normalization. Let's see. Oh, so I'm actually a little bit confused by my own thought. I might have included the wrong thing here. So sorry about that. I'm going to actually show you something quick on the whiteboard, because I've got the wrong plots there. So on the whiteboard, suppose that we have just several different numbers multiplied together.
There's a light that's just for that.
The blue doesn't show up from your distance? Okay, sorry.
That's a lot better.
So we have several different numbers multiplied together. And this is basically the simplest possible neural network that you can imagine. It's a neural network where every number is the weight matrix for a single layer. Every layer has only one unit in it, and there's no nonlinearity. So it's just a purely linear network multiplied through one step at a time. You can imagine that the value of A will determine very much what the statistics of the activations will be like by the time we get to D. But if we added normalization steps after each multiplication, then the value of A doesn't actually determine the mean or the standard deviation over here. So why is that really powerful? The reason is that gradient descent is completely blind to these kinds of interactions between multiple different variables. If we take the gradient with respect to A, we might get a very big or a very small number depending on the values of the other parameters in the network. So the gradient with respect to A is B times C times D times E. And this depends on all four of these parameters. If any of them is close to zero, we end up with a little tiny gradient on A. And if any of them is large, we end up with, or if all of them are large, we end up with an extremely large gradient on A. So some learning algorithms use second order information to try to correct for that kind of effect. They can actually take second derivatives to see how A interacts with each of the other parameters. And then when you do things like invert the Hessian matrix to try to normalize the effect of all the different parameters on each other, you can get reasonable updates if you only have pairwise interactions between parameters. If we look at the second derivatives here, let's take, for example, the derivative of the first derivative with respect to B. We end up with C times D times E. So we actually, even in the second derivative, we have several different parameters interacting together. Using a second order method, like Newton's method, where you compute the Hessian, makes the learning algorithm far more expensive. It ends up being quadratic in terms of the number of parameters just to compute the Hessian matrix, rather than linear in the number of parameters to compute the gradient. And at the end of the day, you've only accounted for second order interactions. But in this network here, we actually have fifth order interactions. So if we went up to try to capture all the fifth order interactions, there wouldn't even be a straightforward way to use a linear algebra solver to account for all those different interactions. And you'd have to compute a value that scales like the number of parameters to the fifth, different derivatives in order to handle it. Because we use batch normalization, we're actually able to knock out some of the most important interactions between the first layer and every other layer, and in fact, between every layer and all the layers that come after it. Rather than looking at A, B, C, and D to determine the mean and standard deviation of E, we need to only look at the gamma and beta parameters that we introduced for that particular layer that comes late in the architecture. And so then SGD is able to adjust just gamma and beta to give the mean that it wants of that layer. And it's able to very safely make large steps on A, B, C, and D without worrying that it's going to completely destroy the statistics at the higher level. So if you look at the actual learning curves that result from using batch normalization, the baseline inception is this dotted black line here. And using batch normalization, it's possible to reach higher levels of accuracy in much less time, in part because the learning rate is much larger, and that learning rate is actually stable now that there are these normalization layers in the network. Another thing that's really interesting is that sigmoid layers, represented by the pink line with the plus signs, can actually be trained quite well. And at the start, they do better than the original inception network without batch normalization did. It's true that the sigmoid values end up saturating a little bit before the accuracy level that's attained by the baseline inception, but they're very competitive. That's really interesting because for years before batch normalization, we thought that it was just infeasible to train sigmoid networks. And a lot of effort went into things like designing pre-training algorithms that would train autoencoders or Boltzmann machines to give us weights that were good initializations for a sigmoid network. But all of those methods were somewhat heuristic. We didn't have clear principles that told us when they would work and when they wouldn't work. And they were very brittle, and they, in fact, did not work in a lot of cases. It took very careful optimization of hyperparameters to get them to work at all. Batch normalization gives us a really easy way to train lots of architectures that were more or less infeasible before. And it's now ubiquitous. You see it in all kinds of different neural network architectures, ranging from residual networks to the latest generative models that everybody's releasing. So this is probably one of the most important ideas in deep learning that's come out in the last 5 years. It's one of the things that's made it possible to train architectures that were extremely difficult to train before. And it's made it so that the search for hyperparameters is much easier because the range of hyperparameters that work really well without destabilizing the learning process has been greatly expanded. That's really it for batch normalization. Does anybody have any questions about that? Yeah.
Do you use batch normalization with dropout, and is there any relationship between the two?
Yeah, so batch normalization introduces some randomness into the training process because we compute these statistics on every mini batch rather than on the entire batch of training examples. The reason we do that is we need to be able to backpropagate through the normalization operation. And having this operation baked into the network makes it so that the layers are always normalized at every step in time. We don't need to do anything like have the layers gradually become unnormalized and then get corrected. But as a side effect of including these operations in the network, we've made it so that the exact mean we subtract and the exact standard deviation we subtract changes every time we load a different mini batch X here. So that makes it so that this step is a little bit like adding random noise, and this step is a little bit like multiplying by random noise. Dropout is traditionally done as multiplying by random noise. Originally it was multiplying by zeros and ones, but it also works really well if you multiply by a Gaussian value with mean one. So in that sense, this step of batch normalization really looks a lot like dropout. Anytime that you inject a lot of noise into a network, you force that model to become robust to that noise. And that helps it to generalize to examples that weren't seen at training time. Because every time you visit that same example while you're training, you don't see exactly the same version of it. You see different noisy versions of it. And when you apply noise to the hidden layers, the noise is even more powerful. So like if you have an image and you add a lot of noise to each of the pixels, you're going to mess up those individual pixels, but you're not going to mess up like a large object part or something like that. If you have a photo of a cat and you add noise to every pixel, you're getting a really grainy image of a cat. But when you apply noise to the hidden units, you can actually remove individual conceptual elements of the image. If your neural network learns to recognize a cat by looking for cat ears, and then you multiply the hidden unit that detects cat ears by zero, it won't be able to detect that cat anymore, and it'll be forced to learn another feature that will allow it to detect the cat. Now, if you're unlucky, it'll just learn a second hidden unit that detects cat ears. But if you're reasonably lucky, and you usually are because you have a lot of hidden units and a lot of presentations of each example, you'll eventually learn another feature that detects like cat noses or cat whiskers or something. And now you have this really robust way of detecting a cat that should generalize to more images. So both Dropout and BatchNorm have that effect because of this. The interesting thing is that Dropout was designed purely as a regularization mechanism. It reduces the gap between your test error and the train error. Batch normalization was designed to make optimization easier, and as a side effect, it happens to do a little bit of regularization. So usually batch norm is not quite as strong of a regularizer as Dropout is. If you have a really small data set, you probably need to also use Dropout. And there were some papers early on that were saying that, for example, batch norm doesn't work with recurrent nets. One issue with the evaluation when people concluded that was that they were using really small data sets and they were measuring test error, not train error. So all that was going on really was that batch norm wasn't regularizing the model very much and it was overfitting because the optimization worked really well. So if you see that happening, you can actually combine Dropout and batch norm together. One thing that's a little bit weird about it is that the Dropout masks will screw up your estimate of the mean and the standard deviation. In practice, that doesn't really seem to matter all that much, but you can actually do the math to correct for it if you want to. Yeah?
A couple of questions. One is, some libraries like Torch use a decaying moving average rather than just the batch average in the batch norm.
When you deploy the neural network at test time, if you want to process different sizes of batches than you deployed at train time, or if you want to make sure that every example is always classified with exactly the same function, you can replace this mean with a running average that was accumulated during training, and you can replace this standard deviation with a running standard deviation that was accumulated during training. At training time, you have to use the statistics collected on the mini batch, and you have to backpropagate through that statistics collection process, or it won't actually work. The gradient will keep proposing changes that try to undo the normalization, and you'll waste a lot of time learning things that just get undone immediately on the next step. But at test time, you're welcome to freeze this once the parameters aren't changing anymore. If you don't freeze it, it means that every time you load a mini batch, like say that the first example in a mini batch we kept fixed, and then we started loading different examples in the other slots of the mini batch, then our output for the first example would change from one mini batch to the next, which seems a little bit weird because it's the same example. The good news is that all those different outputs should be more or less reasonable, just with slightly different variation in their estimate of the exact probabilities. But if you really want to make sure that you always get exactly the same output for exactly the same input, you should freeze these and replace them with single estimates of the mean and variance.
Also, you mentioned recurrent nets. There's been some papers in the last few months specifically looking at variations of batch norm for recurrent nets.
Yeah, so like layer normalization is probably the best thing to use.
Layer normalization?
Yeah, for recurrent networks. So with recurrent networks, you have this funny issue that you sort of see multiplication by the same weight matrix again and again and again, and it's not entirely clear what you ought to do about that. Should you normalize each step independently of the others? Should you try to get some idea of what the mean is going to look like over all steps and then like go back and retroactively apply it to all the different time steps? Layer normalization just normalizes across units rather than across examples. It's really similar to things that people used to do for convolutional networks, where people did like what was called local response normalization. It's sort of like if you take local response normalization and make it extreme to include all the units instead of just some of them. So for convolutional nets, it doesn't seem to be quite as good as batch norm, but for recurrent nets, it seems to be one of the most effective things you can do.
When you're running average thing, why would that not work with training? I mean, if you went down to batch size one, like this doesn't work, right? If batch norm doesn't have anything to normalize over. Right? If you wanted to emulate that, couldn't you just use a large enough running average would somewhat emulate, even during training, a batch run over a large batch size?
So the running average is constant with respect to the parameters. If you look at what subtracting this mean does, that's the easiest one to follow. The standard deviation one gets a little bit nasty, but when you subtract the mean, that guarantees you that the gradient will never propose making a change that just shifts the value of z. So you will actually find that your gradient on z has zero mean when you have this normalization operation in here. If your gradient on z didn't have zero mean, you'd basically be saying, I want all the units to just shift upward a little bit, or I want all the units to just shift downward a little bit across the whole mini batch. And that's sort of useless, right? Because you could just add or subtract any constant value, and the code would have more or less the same semantics. Like the activations across all the different units would be raked in the same way, and they'd have the same amount of space in between them. So if your learning algorithm just proposes doing things that shift all the activations across the mini-batch up or down, you're just kind of wasting time moving the activations around and forcing the other layers to learn that now the activations have a different center. But it's not actually updating anything in a useful way. When you actually include all the other members of the mini-batch as part of the function, that prevents you from just shifting things around as part of the learning process. And the running average, if you use that, it would be the same as if you subtracted off any other constant, really. That the learning process could still propose to move you away from it.
You have a large enough batch, you can estimate the sum of the entire, so far, right? Over a very large average. Can the running average approximate that? I mean, it's changing slowly.
So it's not about the forward pass, it's only in the backward pass that you start to see the problem.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Okay. Yeah.
Does the gamma and beta the same across all the layers?
Usually they're different for every layer.
They're different? So
yeah.
You set them for different layers?
Well, they're parameters that are learned. So you would usually start with beta being set to 0.
Oh, okay.
And gamma being set to 1.
So they're going to learn that. Okay.
Yeah.
Does batch one have any impact on the quality of representations then?
Well, you usually learn better representations because you're able to optimize better. It doesn't change the set of representations that are possible to learn. The gamma and beta make it so that you can learn representations that have any mean and any standard deviation. If we didn't have those in there, it would force you to learn representations that have zero mean and unit standard deviation. And that might restrict you in some way that actually matters. But including these makes it so that you can learn anything that a traditional neural network would learn.
So it learns better representation because we can run it longer? Is that also?
Well, not so much because we can run it longer. Usually we actually run it for less time because it trains so much faster.
Yeah.
You see how this one got up to an accuracy of about 70% and this one got up to an accuracy of about 75% or so. So this one is without batch norm and this one is with batch norm. It's difficult to say exactly how you measure how good a representation is, but I would argue that if you have an ImageNet classifier that can get 75% accuracy, it's probably better than an ImageNet classifier that only gets to 70% accuracy. Especially when both models have the same architecture. It means that the representation used by the more accurate model must be better in some way.
It's basically because like you free it up, the mean and standard deviation, so that it will pick the one that it's better for it, basically.
Yeah.
Because if you don't do that, then it's forced to use whatever the empirical one is.
Yeah.
That's basically it.
But then, I mean, using batch norm also could give more weight to, let's say, lower layers. So that could also, I mean, it has more of an impact on the classification, right? Because that's kind of what batch norm does, right? By bringing the mean to its zero, if you're using a ReLU, you're using a rectifier, then it could have more of an impact on the output. Isn't that what batch norm enables, rather than just moving randomly away from the mean?
It's really hard to say like how much each layer is used. It's kind of difficult to tell which one matters the most, especially for rectified linear units. There's sort of this weird property that you can take any layer and divide it by 2. If you multiply the next layer by 2, and you get the same function back out. So there's not really a clear metric that you can use to look at a network and say which layer is it using the most. Because if you see that the parameters are really big at one layer and really small at another layer, or if you see that the activations are really big at one layer and really small at another layer, you can always just divide the big one by n and multiply the small one by n, and you'd end up with the small one being big and the big one being small. You get the same network back out. So if somebody thinks of a better way other than the size of the weights or the size of the activations to tell which layers are being used the most, then you could try to answer that question. Right now, I don't really know of a good way of answering it. I guess you could do things like maybe add noise where the standard deviation of the noise is like 10% the standard deviation of the layer, and just see like which layer is harmed the most by having proportional noise added to it. I don't know of anybody who's actually done that experiment yet, though. So it would be interesting to see if batch norm results in different parts of the layer being used more or less. I bet it would really depend a lot on, if you don't have batch normalization, I bet it depends a lot on the size of the initial parameters that you choose for each layer.
I wanted to ask, so the networks with batch norm and without are isomorphic in the sense that everything which can be expressed in one can be expressed in the other, right?
Yeah.
So when you train without batch norm and you finish somewhere, right, which is not so good, like 0.7, why it does get stuck there?
Oh, well, because the gradient descent algorithm has trouble seeing that different units are correlated with each other. I guess I don't have Wi-Fi here, right?
You do.
You know what? I might actually have the thing I want to show you on my desktop anyway.
Yeah. Jeremy works here. He can definitely help you with that.
No, I can actually probably find it.
Oh, all right.
Let's see. Maybe I don't actually have it. That might actually have been. I was going to show you something about optimization, but it might be from when I was.
We can just log you in real quick.
On my personal laptop.
We can just log you in real quick if
yeah,
that's
sure.
Okay with you.
Do I need to, like.
Is it still SF Visitor or USF Visitor?
No, I'm just going to USF Wireless.
Wireless.
Okay. Oh, you'll type in the secret code?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, read it to me and I'll repeat it back. Hang out.
That's right, just copy the keylogger out for the back channel.
Thanks, Jeremy.
Yeah, so I'm going to show you, I guess last time we were talking about optimization, right? But,
Oh wait, it's still connecting. Oh, should be good now. Yeah.
So I wasn't here last time, so I hope I'm not repeating too much stuff that everybody's already heard, but once this loads, I can show you some graphics. Tell us a little bit about why gradient descent can fail. So the second derivatives tell you a lot about how your cost function curves. If you have a second derivative of zero, then your cost function is just like a flat line where you are. And that means that the derivatives tell you everything you need to know about it in order to go downhill. If you have non-zero second derivatives, if you have negative ones, it means that the surface kind of curves downhill away from you as you move in the direction where the gradient points downhill. And if you have positive ones, then it means that the surface curves upward as you move away from where you are right now. Then to get more complicated, there's actually lots of different directions in parameter space. So here's a 2D cross section. You can look at all the second derivatives that form what's called the Hessian matrix, telling you the derivative with respect to one parameter and then the second derivative with respect to every other parameter. If you take the Hessian matrix and you take a direction d and you compute d dot product h dot product d, that will actually tell you the second derivative in a specific direction d. So you can imagine that in some directions, you have like a very large positive second derivative, And in other directions, you actually have a small negative second derivative. It turns out that these curvature factors end up really affecting how much you're able to learn from a gradient descent step. So if you make a Taylor series approximation, you can figure out what the value of the cost function will be at some nearby point. So the Taylor series approximation is just where you use all the derivatives at the current point to predict what the value of the function will be somewhere nearby. You've probably seen it in one dimension before. So in one dimension, you have some function f of x, and you want to make an approximation around a point x0. So you start off by saying right here, the value is f of x0. And if I go to some point x that's nearby, I can take the difference between x and x0 and multiply that by the derivative at x0. And that tells me how much the slope says I'm going to go uphill. But then you also bring in this correction factor where you use the second derivative to correct for the slope, either not knowing about downward curvature or not knowing about upward curvature. So the multidimensional generalization of this involves using the Hessian matrix, but it's still basically the same idea. You take the cost at the current point, and you take the dot product between the step to the new point and the gradient, and then you also have this other term involving the Hessian matrix. So you can actually use that approximation to figure out how much the gradient descent step will decrease the cost function value by. So over here, we have this term theta minus theta naught, but this is just the direction of the step we're going to take. If you plug in the learning rate times the gradient to that formula, you get this formula for the value that you think the cost function will have after the gradient step. So it turns out they have two different terms. One of them is you subtract epsilon times the gradient dot producted with the gradient itself. So that's just the squared L2 norm of the gradient. So that says if you have a really big gradient, a gradient descent step is going to decrease your cost a lot. But then there's this second term that you add back in, where it's 1 half times the learning rate squared times the gradient dot product Hessian dot product gradient. So this gradient Hessian gradient term here, well, that's giving us the second derivative in the direction of the gradient descent step multiplied by the norm of the gradient. That tells us is that if we are unlucky and the gradient points in a direction where the function curves uphill really fast, then that upward curve can actually outweigh the downward linear slope. Gradient descent is completely blind to this upward curve. So if you don't reparameterize your model to make these second derivatives be close to zero a lot of the time, you'll end up with those second derivatives becoming really important as you learn. So the way that you can tell how quickly you're going to learn is you look at the ratio between the norm of the gradient and this g transpose hg term. When this is really small, it means that the linear slope is really small compared to the curvature that'll make you go shooting back uphill. Usually, as you train the network, you start out with the bottom not being very big, and the top being really big. But as you train longer and longer, the bottom becomes gigantic. And so you actually still have a gradient, but you inadvertently go uphill because of the curvature all the time. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And no momentum on other fancy gradients and algorithms.
So momentum can help you a lot if your Hessian matrix has eigenvalues that are all close to each other, meaning that the curvature is about the same in every direction. And then Nesterov momentum can help you more if the curvature is very different in different directions. But it gets harder and harder for any second order method to save you the more that you have differences between the curvature in different directions. Any other batch norm questions?
Yeah. What other options for normalization are there? Any promising ones?
Well, so there's weight normalization. That is where you normalize the weights instead of normalizing the activations. And you choose the parameters so that the activations are initialized. And if you're lucky, they'll stay initialized. And it's kind of simpler to analyze than batch norm because every example is processed independently. You can also do batch normalization where you subtract only the mean, and that's a little bit easier to analyze too, because it's not the dependence on the standard deviation. And then if you want to get really obscure, for generative adversarial nets, I use this thing that I call virtual batch normalization, where I want to make sure that I get the same function every time I load a different example. I don't want the function to depend on what the other examples of the mini batch are, but I still want to get the benefits of batch norm. So I introduce a second batch of examples that is kept the same forever, and I compute the mean and the standard deviation on those. And then during training, I load other mini batches, and I normalize them with the statistics of that reference batch. If I only use the reference batch, then sometimes the parameters just sort of learn to avoid causing big activations on the reference batch. So to take it one step further, in virtual batch normalization, you also use the current training example, but not the other ones in the mini batch, to update that mean and that standard deviation. And that seems to work a little bit better. That was pretty important for getting generative adversarial networks to make recognizable dog faces and stuff on ImageNet. Without that trick, I wasn't able to get it to happen reliably. But I don't know of any case other than generative adversarial nets where virtual batch normalization is important.
Do you think the normalization propagation, I was excited about it, but I haven't heard much about it since.
Yeah, similar reaction. Unfortunately, it's gotten to the point where I can't read every paper that comes out anymore. Really big change from 2006, where I'd be like sitting there waiting for Jeff Hinden to post something else. So normalization propagation has been on my to-read list for a long time, but I haven't actually managed to read it yet. Okay, so I'll move on to convolutional nets.
Oh, and if you skip note the rest of the chapter, can I just ask a quick question about the end of the chapter?
Yeah, sure.
Which is the curriculum networks.
Oh, curriculum learning, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't used that myself, but I guess it's this multiplying training paper came out, it seems like it's kind of pretty current. It sounds a lot like boosting, in a sense, that you're like boosting the kind of basic naive version, you're trying to look at examples based on how difficult they are to learn. I guess I just wanted to get a sense of what you felt like this is an area that's kind of important.
My understanding is that it's important for reinforcement learning, and that's also where it was originally discovered, was reinforcement learning in animals. Back then it was called shaping. The idea is basically you start with easier values and you move on to harder values. In terms of mollifying networks in particular, I don't find that paper very compelling for a few different reasons. One is that their values that they learn on Penn Tree Bank are not very competitive with the current state of the art. And it would be more interesting if they were using a harder benchmark than Penn Tree Bank. It would be even more interesting if they were getting competitive results. When they don't get competitive results, it just sounds like their baseline was too weak. And then for some of their other experiments, like training a deep sigmoid network, they're using Xavier Glerot's initialization from like 2009 or so, I don't remember the exact year. That initialization scheme was good when it came out. I'm not bashing that initialization scheme, but it's no longer a competitive baseline. And if they want to compare mollifying networks to vanilla gradient descent, they really ought to use something like random walk initialization by David Cicillo from a few years ago, or the standard data-based active initialization procedures used in things like, there's a paper called All You Need Is a Good Init, or also the weight normalization paper does this. Basically, if you don't initialize SGD carefully and you expect it to work, it's a little bit like dropping a car in the ocean and then concluding that the car doesn't work. Like, if you put the car on a road, it works great. If you put the car in the ocean, it's not going to work because you've just put it in such a hostile environment that you couldn't reasonably expect it to. And, if you could make a case that maybe SGD is broken if the road was really hard to find and the ocean was everywhere. But papers like random walk initialization and All You Need Is a Good Init have shown us that there's a very reasonable road that's very easy to find. And I think anybody who's writing a paper about optimization should use those kinds of initialization techniques as their baseline if they're not ready.
Is orthogonal initialization in that group of approaches as well?
Sorry?
Is orthogonal initialization?
Yeah, I haven't really used orthogonal initialization personally, but there's good theoretical reasons that it should work well. Okay, so I'll go on to convolutional networks. So this is chapter 9 of the book. And the basic idea of convolutional networks is that they are convolutional, they're neural networks that scale up to very large, usually images. They can actually apply to anything that has some kind of grid-like structure to it. So you could use them on sequences if you wanted to. Recurrent nets are usually better for sequences, but you could use convolutional nets on sequences. You can also do 2D convolutional nets on things like spectrograms, where you take an audio signal and you turn it into like a Fourier analysis type feature map where you've got a 2D grid for time and frequency. You can use convolutional networks on videos, things like that. Anything where you have this regular grid structure where you have the same kind of values appearing everywhere, and the spacing between the values is the same everywhere. So convolutional networks help us make neural networks apply to these really big inputs using two different ideas. One of them is sparse connectivity, meaning that most units should not be connected to very many other units. And that allows us to train a model that has really a lot of units in it without needing to learn very many different connections. The other key idea is parameter sharing. The idea that we can use the same parameters in many different locations throughout the model, and that way we don't need to store very many different parameters. And I'll make this more concrete as we go along. The main benefit of convolutional networks is that they allow you to run the model on very big inputs without expending a lot of computational resources. But another secondary benefit they have is that they generalize a lot better because they automatically become invariant to spatial translation of the input. That if you shift a picture of a cat one pixel to the right, a convolutional network will still know it was a cat. But to a traditional neural network, it would need to learn both of those images separately. There's also some generalization that comes just from the fact that you have fewer parameters to learn. So you can get a higher confidence estimate of each parameter. So the key idea behind a convolutional network is to take a traditional neural network, and everywhere you have a matrix multiply, replace that with an operation called convolution. And that's seriously it. It's nothing more complicated than having layers that use convolution in them. Everything else stays the same. You can still train them with maximum likelihood if that's what you were using before. You can still make them Bayesian if you were making them Bayesian before. You can still train them with backpropagation if that's what you were using before. You can still train them with contrastive divergence if that's what you were doing before. It's really just the same math with one other operator in it. So let's revisit what the matrix product looks like really quickly. We have a matrix A and a matrix B. We multiply them together to get a matrix C. If we look at row I and column J of C, we have a dot product between row I of A and column J of B. And this is just a linear operation. We take a bunch of values in A, multiply them by corresponding values in B, and add them all up. So in traditional neural networks, the matrix A is completely unstructured. Convolution, it will turn out, is basically taking a matrix A that has a lot of zeros in it and has a lot of values copied. Now that's maybe not the easiest way to think of it, but that's what makes it run really fast and require very few parameters. You can also multiply by the transpose of a matrix, where you just flip one of the matrices around its diagonal axis before you do the multiplication. And we'll see that you can take this idea of transpose matrices and you can use it to get convolution transpose. So that will actually let us do everything that we need to do to train a neural network. So the most intuitive way to think of the convolution operation is to think of it as taking an input that lies on a two-dimensional grid. And on this grid, I've labeled each cell with a letter just A, B, C, D, as we go across left to right, bottom to top. So these letters are just showing a variable name for each cell. You could actually make this grid any size you want. It doesn't need to be three rows by four columns. But basically, you have an input that's laid out on a grid, and you have a set of parameters called a kernel, which is also laid out on a grid. Usually the input is really big, like maybe a 256 pixel by 256 pixel image. And usually the kernel is really small. Like this 2x2 kernel is actually something that you could totally just go and use in a neural net, it would be fine. The way that you compute the convolution is you take the kernel and you slide it around the image. And every time the kernel visits a position in the image, you compute one pixel of the output. So the output will also be a big grid, and every pixel in that grid is a dot product between the kernel and a patch of the image. So I've drawn this little box here to pretend that we're overlaying the kernel on the upper left position of the input, and we're computing this upper left pixel of the output. So the dot product between this little patch of the input and the kernel is A times W, so we write that here, plus B times X, so we also write that here, plus E times Y, so we also write that here, and then F times Z, so we also write that here. We add up those four values, and that's the value that we put in this output pixel. So then we can continue to fill in the rest of the output by moving the kernel around. So this first row, second column of the output would be made by taking the dot product of the kernel and this little patch here containing B, C, F, and G. Does that make sense to everybody? If anybody has any questions, this is a good point to jump in because you'll be really lost if anything's unclear here. Yeah?
Maybe a little bit irrelevant, maybe a slight tangent. Why does everyone use odd number convolutions if even also works?
I'm not sure what you mean. Odd
width and height of the kernel. This is 2x2, everyone wants to use 3x3, and I don't understand why.
It's perfectly legitimate to use odd. 3x3 does seem kind of popular right now. I'm not entirely sure why. But you know, that changes over time. Mm-hmm. A while ago, a lot of people were using like even or power of two. And now people are using three. I think the power of two craze was because it was more efficient for some versions of the GPU kernel. And I actually don't know the reason for why 3x3 is so popular right now.
I think the reason is because you know where the center is, and then you kind of can locate that you have the center and things around basically project to that center. It's like median filter without filters in image processing.
Okay, so this is what the 2D convolution operation looks like on a single dimensional image and a single dimensional kernel. When we actually run them in a convolutional network, it's hard to draw on a screen. There's actually going to be multiple channels of the image. So here I've basically treated it like it was a grayscale image. But in a real image, there would be another axis to this coming forward out of the screen. So you might have an image that has three pixels of depth, one for the red color channel, one for the green color channel, one for the blue color channel. Or other encodings do things like intensity and then two chroma values. But the basic idea is if you have color, you'd have three different pixels of depth coming out of the board. And then on the output layer, you can learn as many different channels of the convolution output as you want. So they're sometimes called channels, sometimes called feature maps. There's a few different terms that are used in just some labs. And the idea is each of those output maps can learn a completely different kind of feature. So the kernel is going to extract the same feature all across every different point in space. And then different channels allow you to extract different features. And you also get a map of where that feature occurs all over space for each of those channels. So you might have something like on the very first layer, your input might have three channels and your output might have 32. But then on the second layer, your input would have 32 channels. And you could set your output to have 32 channels or 64 channels, whatever you want. Yeah?
Yeah,
So if you have two different output channels, the reason that they can be different, is it because you initialize the weights to something different?
Well, it's because they have separate weights. So when we move across space, we're using the same weights everywhere. So this kernel has weights W, X, Y, and Z. And this pixel uses weights W, X, Y, and Z in the output. So does this pixel here. It's also W, X, Y, and Z. Now imagine that we had two output channels instead of just one. That would mean we have a third axis coming out of the board. And so our kernel would actually have four more parameters in it. Let's just call them like S, T, U, and V. And then our output would also have a whole other channel to it stacked on top that we can see here.
But if W, X, Y, Z were initialized to be the same values as S, T, U, and V, wouldn't you just have the exact same output?
That's why you usually initialize your parameter values randomly, so that the chance of any two parameters being identical is very low. You'd have the same issue with different units of a traditional neural network if you initialized two columns of your weight matrix to be identical to each other. Depending on the learning algorithm, you might actually be able to separate those. If you use gradient descent with no randomness at all, you probably won't separate them. But if your implementation has some kind of asynchronicity in it, then you might, just by using asynchronous gradient descent, you might get really lucky and separate to the weight vectors. If you have like batch norm or dropout or something like that, I think batch norm actually won't do it because the two means and standard deviations are the same as each other, but dropout could actually cause you to separate two weight vectors that were initialized the same as each other. So there's really three different operations that you need to build a convolutional network. The first of them is just the convolution operation that I described. And the second one is deconvolution, which is actually sort of a misnomer. Deconvolution really should refer to the inverse of convolution, but people use it to refer to this operation that's multiplication by the transpose of the matrix that you use to do convolution. Over here, I didn't really spell this out as being a matrix, but you could imagine reshaping the input to be a big vector rather than being laid out on a grid. You could imagine reshaping the output to also be a vector. And it would turn out that this operation that we've drawn here is equivalent to multiplying by a really big matrix that has lots of copies of W, X, Y, Z in it and lots of zeros. And it's called a doubly blocked circulant matrix. And you almost never need to know that. The only reason it really comes up in deep learning is that you can use it to understand that you can do a transpose of the convolution operation. So the transpose, it really just looks like running this process in reverse. You visit each pixel of the input, and you multiply the weights by corresponding pixels in the output to sort of do this same flow, but backwards. And it's essentially exactly the same thing as when you multiply by the transpose of a weight matrix in a traditional neural network. So where does this multiplication by transpose come up? Mostly in the backpropagation algorithm. When you do forward propagation, you multiply by the weight matrix. You multiply the input by the weight matrix. When you do backpropagation, you end up multiplying the error derivatives on the output by the weight matrix transpose. So you end up doing exactly the same thing for backprop in a convolutional network. Instead of having a grid of output values, you end up with a grid of gradient values telling you the derivatives on your outputs. And then you apply the transpose convolution operation with the same kernel you used for forward prop. You just run it backwards and get error derivatives on your input map. There's one other place that this convolution transpose operation comes up, and that will be, it'll make more sense in later chapters. When you have things like autoencoders or restricted Boltzmann machines, if any of you already know what those are, a lot of the time you need to get reconstructions of what the input looked like, given some hidden code. And the transpose convolution operation is the way that you make a convolutional autoencoder. or a convolutional restricted pulse machine. If you don't know about autoencoders or restricted pulse machines yet, don't worry about what I just said, and I realize it made no sense whatsoever. Then the third place that you actually need a different operation for a convolutional net is there's a special operation that backpropagates the error from the output map to the weights. So we didn't actually really need a special operation for matrix multiplication. That's because when you do a traditional neural network where you just multiply by a matrix that has a different parameter value at every row and every column, there's no sharing of parameters. Every parameter is used exactly once. In a convolutional network, you reuse each parameter at every position in the input, and every position in the input adds another term to the derivative on that individual parameter. So we need this special operation that goes around to all the different points in space and adds up all the derivatives that fall on the same parameter. And I realize this is a very hand-wavy description. All you really need to understand is why there has to be this third operation there to account for the parameter sharing. You don't really need to worry about how you would actually write that operation unless you find yourself implementing the next version of TensorFlow or something like that. You can usually just make use of the one that's already there for you in TensorFlow.
A quick question about the deconvolution. Is it the same deconvolution as when you try to realize the activations, like you do deconvolution of the maximal activation to the input?
Yeah, that's one thing that you can use the deconvolution operation for.
Okay, but you have to remember that, the maximal activation when you do pulling, right? You have to remember that
deconvolution just refers to the linear step. And when you make the activation visualization, you have all these other steps, like supplying the map of maximums as input to the deconvolution operation. And then you have extra steps that come after it to finish processing it. You're talking about the deconvolutional networks.
Yeah.
Yeah, so those have several pieces to their architecture, but probably the most important piece is the linear deconvolution step. So like a convolutional network has many pieces to it, right? There's the input layer, there's convolution, there's rectified linear activations.
Yeah.
A deconvolutional network also has several steps to it,
okay,
like the max pooling and remembering which unit was maximal and things like that.
Exactly.
Those are just extra pieces of the architecture built around the deconvolution steps.
Okay, so here you're only referring to one part.
Yeah, exactly.
Can you go once more how the convolution or the deconvolution is combined with the backpropagation?
So let me draw something on the board really quick. I hope this looks okay. So for any kind of neural net, you have something like an input X, and then you have a weight matrix for each layer. So let's call this one like W1. You get a matrix of activations, we'll call that like H1. Then you do another weight matrix multiplication, I think called like W2, for example. And at the top, let's say you get some loss. So during forward prop, we move up this way and get the loss. And then during back prop, we go down this way and get the gradients. So during forward prop, we do computations like X times W1. And then we apply the rectified linear function to get H1. And then we do things like H1 times W2 to get the next activation until eventually come up to the loss. During backprop, we get things like the error at different layers. So like, let's say we have something like a value E here. You can do things like take E and multiply by W2 transpose to get the error derivatives with respect to layer 1. So let's call that like E1. So this is multiplication by a matrix transpose here. For a convolutional net, this would be convolution by a kernel W1, and this would be convolution transpose by a kernel W2. And then this continues down following the same pattern. You continue to use the transpose. The third operation that comes in, the gradient with respect to the weights, you actually take H1 and you take the error on the output of W2 and you get, let's just call it like G2 is the gradient with respect to the weights for layer 2. It's getting a little bit messy. I have a lot of arrows. I'm sorry. Does it make sense?
I think it's actually the ones before the activation times the G, right?
So the ones before the activation. No, so
for the gradient.
If I'm looking for the gradient on W2, I need to know the input to the matrix multiply involving W2.
Yes, yes.
And I need to know the gradient with,
of that one.
I need to know the gradient with, oh, I entered the arrow wrong over here, yeah, so it's, no, actually, sorry.
I think you're right.
Yeah, I didn't actually draw a single variable for
it's for
the gradient I want, yeah. So this little expression here gets fed into the gradient with respect to weights operation.
So that one is gradient.
Well, there are, many of these are gradients. This one is a gradient with respect to activations. This one is a gradient with respect to weights.
So basically, the H times that one is a gradient with respect to the weights. So it's the gradient on the right side times the input on the left side. When you multiply them, you get the gradient on the, you just keep doing that balance.
Ian, a couple of things. When the audience asks questions, if you could just repeat the questions,
like
below.
The
comment was
long.
And then white chalk, if you could use that. It's their demands, not mine.
Demands, I see. Okay.
Yeah.
There is some white chalk over here. I'll move the colored chalk away. Don't forget to keep this in there. All right.
Why does a general size has to be small? Does it not depend on everyone in your layer and everyone else?
So in principle, the kernel size could be large. If you made the kernel size equal to the input size, you would get a normal neural network back out. The smaller the kernel size, the fewer parameters you have, and the fewer operations it takes to compute the activations and to compute the gradients. And the more likely it is that you'll learn parameters that generalize well. If you're trying to learn a kernel that's the size of the whole image, it probably won't really generalize very much. Like if I show you a photo of a dog and you learn a kernel that looks like just a big picture of a dog, that's not going to happen again in your test set. But if I show you a picture of a dog and you learn like a little kernel that looks for a difference in brightness between two pixels, then that'll find you the edges of the dog. And those edges are more likely to appear somewhere in the test set and be useful there. Okay. Yeah.
How much how much can you translate pictures, move them? How what's that invariant?
That will be easier to answer later after I've described pooling, so I'll postpone that question. Okay, so one of the main ideas behind convolutional nets is the idea of sparse connectivity. And that means that very few units should be connected to each other. If you have a densely connected layer, a traditional neural network layer based on multiplication by a matrix, let's say that you get some inputs x1 through x5, and you compute some linear activations that I'll just call s1 through s5. Every value in s1 through s5 is a function of every value in x1 through x5. And so the number of connections that we have to compute is quadratic in the size of these layers. In a convolutional network, we can fix the kernel size, and we get just a few units in S connected to just a few units in X. So here we have a kernel size of 3 for this example. And we see that this one value X3 only ends up affecting these three values in S. So we actually have a constant number of outputs that are affected by any individual input instead of a linear number. And that allows us to scale the output layer to be really large without having to have more and more parameters every time we make it larger. Another way of looking at sparse connectivity is looking at one of the output units and seeing which input units affect it. And we get the same pattern there. If your layer is densely connected, then every output unit is affected by every input unit. But if you have a convolutional network, then any individual output unit is affected by only a constant number of input units. That means that if you only go through one layer of a convolutional network, each output unit doesn't get to see very much input space. So here, it only gets to see three input units. So you might think that that prevents it from being able to understand large images. The way that that problem gets fixed is that when you have multiple layers, the total receptive field, the area that a unit sees, grows as you move from one layer to the next. So if I have an input layer X, and then a hidden layer H, and then another hidden layer G, every unit in G only sees three units in H. But then each of those units in H sees three units in X. And because each H unit sees a different set of three X units, we actually end up with G3 seeing all five X units. And you can imagine that as you have more and more layers, you actually see more and more units, and you can end up with really large receptive fields. The other key idea behind convolutional networks is the idea of parameter sharing. So in this graph, gray arrows are just sort of the background, and I highlight one parameter by drawing it with black arrows, and we see everywhere that that one parameter appears. So for a convolutional network, we see black arrows on every single spatial input. We see a single parameter get repeated at every single position in input space. But for a traditional neural network represented by a dense matrix, each parameter appears in exactly one place. It doesn't get shared at all. So what this means is if we've built a kernel that looks for something like an edge, we only need to learn about detecting an edge once, and then we can apply that edge detector everywhere. In a traditional convolutional network, you would need to rediscover the concept of edges separately for every pixel in the image. Yeah?
So suppose the task was to recognize everybody who had, among people who had a black hat and white shoes, and those parts of the image were very far from each other. Would convolutional network be able to pull it off because it's thinking about things that are, you know, right next to each other, because it's only right next to each other?
It would need to be sufficiently deep. And it would need to, so it would need to have a lot of depth to find the hat and the shoes first. And then we need to have some more depth to allow the signal to propagate from any one place that the hat or the shoes came in to anywhere else they might be. Also, if you knew that your task was of that form, you could do something like put in a pooling feature that takes the maximum across the entire feature map or something like that. Usually those hand-coded features aren't quite as nice as just using convolution everywhere. But using convolution everywhere and making the model really deep can learn to do some very surprising things that are hard to hand design. But you're right that it is somewhat difficult for them to do, but they can eventually handle it. Also, modern convolutional networks are really, really deep. If you read papers like the residual networks paper or deep networks of stochastic depth, there are like hundreds or I think even 1,000 layers sometimes now. Do you have a question? Or?
Yes.
Yeah.
In the book, there's some neuroscience explanation for lots of like locality in convolutional neural nets. Parameter sharing, I guess there's...
So yeah, I'll talk about the neuroscience a little bit later. I'll get to that later in the presentation.
Are there any obvious conceptual weaknesses? I mean, it does feel like there's a certain locality to the way that it analyzes things, connectedness, like telling the difference between two spots and three, something like that.
So the question is whether there's any conceptual limitations. Yeah, I realize that I was pretty.
Don't worry about it.
I did totally put the white chalk over there. I got to get some points for that. Okay. So the question is whether there's any conceptual limitations to convolutional networks, like being too restricted in terms of locality, if they're not able to see three spots, for example. So people actually have a problem where there's a picture that's going kind of viral right now. And I'll see if I can pull it up. There's even a Verge article on it. So this is working for me because I'm standing right in front of the laptop. I don't know if it's working for you because you're looking at it from a different distance. But if I look at the very center of this image, I only see three dots right now. I see the two in the center, and then depending on if I'm a little bit left of center or a little bit right of center, I'll see either the dot on the far left or the dot on the far right. And then, you know, if I look at the top row, I see dots on the top row. If I look at the bottom row, I see the dots on the bottom row. But I can never actually see more than three dots. I don't know if any of you can see more than three, but supposedly no one can see all 12 at the same time. And I haven't actually read the article, so I'm not going to pretend to give you the neuroscience explanation for this particular illusion. But basically, my point with this is just that lots of machine learning models, including the human visual system, have limitations with how many different things they can see at the same time. And in terms of convolutional networks, if you make the kernel big enough and you make there be like two layers or more to it, then the universal approximator theorem applies. So it should be able to represent any function. I haven't really thought a lot about what happens as you shrink the kernel size in terms of the theoretical limits on its representation ability. My guess would be that if you make it deep enough, it can eventually emulate a Turing machine, and so the results for recurrent nets would apply. And in terms of whether it's being really restricted to looking at things like translation, people are always getting interested in building in other transformations like rotation and things like that, but they're very hard-coded, and that hasn't really yielded a payoff yet. One thing that's a little bit difficult about trying to handle more transformations than just translation is that you end up with this exponential explosion in the size of the activations. So convolutional networks as we use them today compute many translations in the x direction and y direction of the same kernel, and so you get a two-dimensional space. Now imagine we wanted to do many different rotations of the same kernel. We'd actually have to add a third axis. So we would end up with, instead of needing O of n squared memory and time, we get O of n cubed memory and time. And then if we added like scaling as well as rotation, we'd have O of n to the fourth. So those efforts haven't really gone very far so far. Yeah.
Question from Fred Keybox. Does the expansion of the input field of the kernel mean that it automatically learns images at all different scales?
Well, not really. So it will learn to see larger and larger spaces, but it's not automatically applying the same function at many different scales. So let's look at this slide. So H2 might learn to detect edges that are very, very small in a high resolution image. And then G3 might learn to see where all those edges were in a large region of that high resolution image. But then let's say that we took a small image and we upscaled it to fill the large resolution. The edges in that very small image are going to occupy very many pixels in the new large image. And it might be hard for an individual element of H to see them now that they've become so big. So the network is not scale invariant, even though it has learned to see a very wide image. Things like the inception network get around this by having layers that take the input and then concatenate extracted features to the input. And then the next layer up sees the input again. So that means if you have an image that's very high resolution, then it will immediately start to get processed with fine resolution feature detectors. But then if it's lower resolution, it'll get concatenated several times before eventually some edge detector starts to pick them up. And that gives it a little bit of ability to deal with different scales that wasn't present in the original one. I don't know if this has been extremely well studied. My guess would be that the main way that convolutional nets deal with lots of different scales is that they learn lots of different parameters that are each attuned to a different scale. And they seem to be able to generalize fairly well doing that.
I just wanted to put in an extra thing about the rotational symmetry, a different point of view. Sonder Dillman, who's now at DeepMind, won two cable competitions in which an architecture involving rotational symmetry was important to winning those competitions. So like there is some signs of getting some important study results by using those architectures, so I don't think it's a dead end.
Okay. And a lot of what I say is probably overly specific to processing photographs of objects. I think this kind of contest
is one where recognizing galaxies and recognizing plankton, which are both things where any type of rotation is fine, whereas something like a motor car, not so much.
Yeah, so most things I can say, you can assume I'm talking about things like optical character recognition or like recognizing pictures of dogs and stuff like that. And then anything I say, take it with a grain of salt the further you move from that application area.
Could you touch a bit on a bottleneck one-on-one, like in the inception model?
Bottlenecks, just like going through very small regions of the network, or?
Yeah, like one-on-one by one kernel.
Oh, I see what you mean, yeah, okay. So inception networks have layers that use a one-by-one kernel so that they're only actually looking at a single position in space for every individual pixel of output space that they make. And a lot of the time, these one-by-one convolutions are designed with a stack of kernels that has fewer outputs than it has inputs. So that's why they call it a bottleneck, is that you reduce the total number of channels in the representation. The use of the one-by-one convolution lets you do a dot product with all the channels that were there before. So you can sort of summarize those channels in a low-dimensional space. It's a little bit like doing PCA or something like that. I'm not as up to date on the latest statistics about designing object recognition architectures. I don't remember whether the purpose of the bottleneck layers is just to reduce the number of computations or if it helps to generalize better. But it is playing a role similar to PCA, which can do either of those things.
Is it possible to share the weight of the kernel neurons to construct learning? For example, if you take a dog recognition, is it possible to take the same model and reuse the weight to learn to detect cats?
Yeah, so there's a paper called, I think it's called How Transferable Are Convolutional Network Features? And they study what happens when you take the weights from different layers of the network and use them to initialize other tasks. And I believe that the lower layer weights, where you're learning things like edges and then corners and so on, that those transfer better than the higher layer weights. But I don't actually remember precisely what their findings were.
There was also a paper before that called Convolutional Features Off the Shelf, for linear layer on top of the last layer, I think, on that, and they got state-of-the-art results on 11 out of 12 vision data sets, so it's a really interesting area.
So in this example, we have a picture of a dog, and we have a 2x1 kernel, where it has a positive one in one place and a negative one in another place. And we can use this kernel to do edge detection. So the one is going to respond where pixels are bright, and the negative one is going to respond where pixels are dark. We're basically taking the difference of two neighboring pixels, and this will give us like a signed edge detector. So in the output image, we get black pixels where we have a transition from bright to dark, and we get white pixels where we have a transition from dark to light. And then you can imagine doing things like taking the absolute value of this, or taking the L2 norm of this and another like vertical edge detector, and give us an idea of where all the edges in an image are. So convolutional networks are often learning features like this internally. We don't need to program this positive one, negative one kernel into them, but this gives you an example of seeing how it is that they're actually able to process an image and get a map that tells them where different kinds of things are happening in an image. So here we've converted the image of a dog, which is really difficult for a program to process, into a map of where there are edges in the image. We can also look at this example to see why convolution is so efficient. So here this image is 320 by 280. Our kernel has size 2 by 1, and that means the output size shrinks by 1 in the direction where the kernel was 2 and stays the same in the direction where the kernel was size 1. We can think about two different things that have costs to them. One of them is how much it costs to store all the parameters that we use to represent the edge detection operation. And the other thing is the number of multiplications and additions that we have to do in order to actually compute the edge detection for the whole image. We can think about three different ways of doing this. One of them is with convolution, which is, you know, the way that we actually do it in practice. One of them is what would happen if we tried to use a dense matrix, where we actually just have a different floating point value for every location in the image. Now, if we did this edge detection operation with a dense matrix multiplication, that matrix would be zero at almost every position. So it would be just, you know, grotesquely inefficient to do it with a dense matrix multiplication. So we can imagine doing it with a sparse matrix multiplication, where we see that every column of the matrix actually has only two entries in it. And then that would allow us to do the whole thing a lot more efficiently. So convolution allows us to store only two floats, the positive one and the negative one. The dense matrix would require us to store over 8 billion. And it would require us to do, and the sparse matrix would require us to store close to 200,000 floating point numbers. And then we'd actually have to store a few integers to keep track of where those floating point numbers were. But I'm ignoring them because you can see this is already a much larger number than we have. Then if you want to actually go ahead and do the arithmetic to run the convolution, it takes about 250,000 operations to run convolution to extract the edges in this image. With the dense matrix multiplication, using the naive matrix multiplication algorithm, which is like a for loop over rows and columns, it takes about 16 billion floating point operations to produce the output image. So this is obviously far more efficient. The sparse matrix multiplication would actually take about the same number of floating point operations as convolution would. Actually, the only real difference between the two is that the sparse matrix multiplication would need to do a lot of indexing operations to look up where it should pull the different parameter values from. So overall, convolution gives us an extremely clear advantage in terms of the amount of parameters we have to store. And it gives us a noticeable advantage in terms of the amount of arithmetic we have to do.
So if we did the dense matrix, would we learn anything more?
Well, the dense matrix can represent any kind of transformation at all, really, any kind of linear transformation. In practice, you wouldn't learn much of anything because, well, if you imagine you have like an infinitely fast computer, then it could actually get through a lot of examples, but it would overfit really badly. You know, ImageNet only has 1.2 million examples. So if you want to fit 8 billion parameters to 1 million examples, you're going to overfit really seriously.
Rupesh Moore asks, do convolutional networks only work on images, or can it be applied to things like financial data, such as stocks or fund data?
Yeah, they can be applied to anything that has a grid-like topology. So if you have a lot of measurements of like a stock price every time, you can apply convolution there, in principle at least. Neural networks have usually not been quite as useful for really noisy financial data as they are for really nicely structured data of the kinds that, you know, human beings experience in daily life. The other thing is finance tends to have what's called a non-stationary distribution, meaning that the rules that determine how the data updates over time change over time. So the rules of the game actually change as different traders start to use different strategies. If you roll out one trading strategy, then all the other firms are going to react to your trading strategy. And so something that worked really well for you today might not work very well for you tomorrow. Now, that means that convolution applied over a long sequence might not be all that valid. You might need to extract a very different function later in time than you did earlier in time.
Do people also use sparse images, not only sparse matrix?
Yeah, so that happens a little bit. It's not very popular. Benjamin Graham, I think, won one of the CIFAR-10 contests by using a very large sparse image. So he essentially took a normal photograph and then added lots of zeros on the side of it so that he could make a really big convolutional layer just by convolving with lots of zeros and getting a very wide spatial dimension on the output. And that required a lot of special operations to deal with the sparsity. That's kind of a niche case. Most people don't really use sparse operations most of the time. Probably the only sparse operation that's really popular in machine learning is the word embedding lookup for language models. Yeah?
I'm wondering if they can count. So if it was necessary, if a property such as this item, to accept it as a case, this item has to have 12 yellow things in it, would some CNN topology succeed at it?
So yeah, CNNs can count. I wrote a paper with some of my colleagues at Google back when I was an intern there called Multi-Digit Number Recognition with Street View House Numbers. And the idea is that the Street View car goes around and takes pictures of address numbers, and then we need to know what the number was in the address in order to put it in the map. For different addresses, there's different numbers of digits in the number. You might have a street where the house numbers are just like 1, 2, 3, or you might have a larger street where there's something like, 1837. So the convolutional network needs to actually tell you how many digits there are, as well as the identity of each of the digits. And they're able to do that just fine. They have to be deep to do it well, but they're able to do it.
I just want to mention that the sparse concat you mentioned, it's quite cool because Ben Graham's sparse concat library, what it actually does is it basically memoizes the result of calculating little pure zeros. So there's actually no computational overhead, even though it adds this huge number of zeros around the outside. It doesn't add any computational overhead to a standard CNN. And so the benefit is that with a normal CNN, the pixels around the outside don't really get much opportunity to be involved in kind of deep interactions because, like, they don't. If you think about it, the pixel in the middle is involved, deeper in the network. I guess it's basically implicitly part of those convolutions that one's on the outside out. But he adds enough padding around the outside that every pixel gets an equal weight. So, sci-fi cameras are small images. So that's why it's super helpful for small bridges for that extra padding.
So convolutional networks have several different components. Until a few years ago, they mostly had an input layer, followed by convolution, followed by some kind of nonlinearity, followed by what's called a pooling stage, which would shrink the size of the representation and summarize the activations in each area. More recently, this pooling stage has become less popular, and it's been replaced by a simplified version where there's just convolution and nonlinearities. But some architectures still involve pooling. So what is pooling exactly? The most common version of pooling is what's called max pooling. The idea is that each output unit of the pooling operation is the maximum of a set of units that are the inputs to each pooling unit. So let's look at this pooling unit right here. Its inputs are this input unit, and this input unit. And we just compute the maximum of them. There's an 0.1, a 1, and an 0.2. So the largest of those is the 1, and we just pass the 1 up out here. And actually, all of these different pooling units can see that 1, and it's the largest value in the input, so all of these output units have a value of 1. Only the rightmost pooling unit fails to see that 1. Its inputs are just this 0.2 and this 0.1 here, so it outputs an 0.2. The reason that these pooling activations are nice is that they allow us to become invariant to translation, or at least partially invariant to very small translations. So if we imagine translating the input one unit to the right, we get a new value over here of 0.3 that's translated in from off the screen before. This value of 0.1 translated off the screen and it's gone now. And we also have this sequence of 0.1, 1, 0.2. That's still present here, but it's one unit farther to the right than it was before. So we've got 0.1, 1, and 0.2 here. If we were using something like a convolutional layer, shifting the input by one pixel to the right would shift the output by one pixel to the right. And that's called equivariance to translation. If you're using something like a matrix multiplication with a separate value for every entry, then it would be difficult to predict what would happen when we shift the input by one unit to the right. With a pooling layer, we actually know that a lot of the pooling units are not going to change at all. So this particular value right here and this one here, they were a 1 before and they're a 1 after. It's because they're only really based on what the largest unit in the receptive field is. And the translation was small enough that the largest unit didn't leave their receptive field. And they also didn't have a larger unit come into their receptive field. Yeah?
I'm a little confused here. Is that max pooling with stride 1?
It is, yeah.
Okay.
So max pooling with stride 1 will get you some invariance to translation. It won't reduce the size of your representation at all.
So if you do away with this layer, then you lose the invariance to your translation?
Well, it isn't built in automatically, but you can learn it. If your layers have the universal approximation property, they can essentially learn to do something resembling max pooling, but more attuned to the kinds of transformations you actually see in the data. So yeah, max pooling was very popular until a few years ago. And then there was a paper called the All Convolutional Net, and that got rid of the pooling layers. And now it's more common to not have those. Like, for example, in generative adversarial networks, there was a paper called Deep Convolutional Generative Adversarial Networks, where they took the architecture I was using with max pooling in it, and they switched to the all-convolutional net architecture, and they got much better results. And now, basically, no one uses max pooling in generative adversarial nets anymore. So you could also imagine doing max pooling across different channels of the input, rather than across space. And that's essentially what's done in max-out units. When you pool across different channels can learn to represent different things. And then you can learn to become invariant to whatever kind of transformation explains the differences between the different channels. So here we have a channel representing one rotated version of a 5, another rotated version of a 5, and another rotated version of a 5. And regardless of which rotation of the 5 appears in the input, as long as there's a 5 there, you'll get one of these units to activate quite a lot. So this input activates the unit on the left quite a lot. This unit activates the unit on the right quite a lot. Either way, the pooling unit ends up seeing a large response. So this allows the neural network to learn which transformations it wants to be invariant to, instead of just having invariants hard-coded into it. Yeah.
I guess I see some overlap between this and maxed out. I guess I was just wondering, is what you said about pooling also true of maxed out, like people using maxed out nowadays with success?
So maxed out has not ended up becoming super popular. I'm obviously a biased source of information because I invented maxed out. My own feeling is that it's just sort of a cultural thing. I think that like if maxout had been invented first, it would probably be more popular. When I first invented maxout, I thought that it performed a lot better than rectified linear units. In my original paper, I was able to seriously outperform the state of the art on several benchmarks using maxout, where previously rectified linear units had been used. And I went to a lot of effort, my co-authors and I went to a lot of effort to make sure that our rectified linear networks had a fair chance. You know, like we used rectified linear models that were much larger than our maxout models and things like that. And we were able to outperform our own baselines as well as the previous state of the art.
Are you still using maxout in your own work?
I am, yeah. So maxout usually performs roughly comparably to rectified linear units, and in rare cases it performs better. So the complexity of implementing it usually deters most people from using it.
So you don't have a non-linearity other than...
taking the max, yeah. But keep in mind that that's the same as rectified linear units. So
and
rectified
so
linear units are taking the max between...
How many of those kind of parallel networks are you maxouting over from more like a couple or dozens? Or?
Usually 2 to 5.
What's the insight in maxout?
So maxout is the combination of using cross-channel pooling and getting rid of the zero in the rectified linear unit. So you have linear functions and you take maxes of, the easiest version is just you take a max of the pair, a pair of responses. So a rectified linear unit is you take the max between zero and a weight vector multiplied by the input. A maxout is you take 2 weight vectors, you multiply each of them by the input, and then you take the max of the result. So it's just a generalization where instead of having a zero on one side, you have a linear response where there would usually be that zero. So a rectified linear unit looks kind of like this, and maxout looks kind of like this, but both pieces can move around a bit. So you can actually have maxout learn to imitate a rectified linear unit, or it can learn to do like the absolute value function, or it can learn to just be perfectly linear if that's what the network wants at that point. And doing that allows the gradient to propagate through a lot better. I guess part of the other reason that maxout might be less popular now is that when we first started using that, we had these really chain structured feed forward architectures. We'd have one layer and then another layer and then another layer. We didn't have all these things like ResNets where you keep adding differences to the same layer over and over again. And so the vanishing gradient problem is a lot worse. And also batch norm didn't exist yet. So the vanishing gradient problem was a lot worse. A lot of the problems that maxout solved for you are now solved by other means.
And I guess you have twice as many parameters if you've got like 2 lines.
No, if you look at the network as a whole, it doesn't really matter all that much because you reduce if you look at just one layer, it looks like you have more parameters, but that's overlooking the fact that you reduce the number of outputs from that layer. And so then the next layer has to process fewer inputs. So it gets to save parameters on the input size being smaller. So it's only like a constant factor of difference. And if you have like a really deep net, it's not really, the number of parameters added is not really noticeable.
Does batch norm help as much though when you're using maxout instead of ReLU?
Yeah, and actually one thing that's kind of interesting is for ReLUs, you really want to use batch norm after the matrix multiply because that's much more likely to have a Gaussian distribution to it. And then for maxout, so if you have a rectified linear unit and you make a histogram of what your activations look like, you get a really big spike at zero, and then you'll get the other 50% of your activation smeared around somewhere else. For maxout, the fact that you're taking a max makes the distribution skew a bit to the right, but it's not incredibly far from Gaussian. So you can actually batch norm the output of the maxout units instead of batch norming the output of the matrix multiply, or you can even batch norm both if you want, and they work fairly well.
So you have, say, 100 channels, right?
Yes.
To which channels you would apply max out, like how would you group them?
Well, so you'd usually get, so let's say that you have just different activation values in a vector. This is before we move to convolutional nets. You take like every consecutive pair and max them. So then if you have a convolutional net, you'll have channels that are stacked on top of each other like this. And you'll do element-wise max at every consecutive pair. Straining my 3D drag abilities here. But these two channels get element-wise maxed to make this channel, which is the same shape as the original two. And these two channels get element-wise maxed to make this channel.
Is there a way to connect it randomly?
I tried doing that while writing the original paper, and it didn't really help. I also thought that like overlapping maxes would work better, but that didn't actually happen. For convolutional networks, where you just do max pooling across space, you usually want the maxes to overlap with each other. But for max-out networks, that always performed worse in my experiments. I don't really know why. And so that's how you can learn invariance to rotation and other transformations. The other thing you can do with max pooling is you can get a downsampling effect, where the output map has a smaller spatial extent than the input map. So you can do that just by having a stride between each of your pooling regions, where that stride is greater than one. So here we have a pooling region width of 3 and a stride of 2. So this unit looks over here, and then the next unit looks 2 units farther to the right. So this allows you to summarize your layer. You used to have, you know, 3 values for, you used to have twice as many values describing the activations, and you just kind of thrown out some of the smaller ones in order to make the new output. But as I said, this kind of operation is less popular now. What people use more often now is they just put the stride in the convolution operator itself. So rather than moving the convolution kernel one position every time you produce a new output unit, you move the convolution kernel by some stride, which in this example here is 2. It's equivalent to downsampling the output of a traditional convolution by a factor of that stride. So you can imagine running a traditional convolution and then just pulling out every 2 values from it and making that be your output map. Yeah.
Do you know why fractional max pooling hasn't gotten more attention? Ben Graham won that diabetic retinopathy competition.
It's always really hard to say why something hasn't gotten attention. It's more of a sociology question than a machine learning question.
Okay, but as far as you know, there's no particular scientific reasons.
So yeah, like I guess if you ask me, like why have I not used fractional max pooling? The biggest reason would be that, as far as I know, it needs a special CUDA kernel to be implemented,
right.
And I just didn't have one sitting around integrated into my own framework. So, you know, I always have a priority queue of research ideas to try out, and they sort of bubble to the front based on having a high potential payoff and having a low cost of implementation. So if I have to go messing around in CUDA, it's going to take a miracle for something to get to the front of my priority queue. The other thing is that I think the results of that were on CIFAR 10.
There was also diabetic retinopathy, which is a 4,000 by 4,000 pixel high res picture survival.
Yeah, but diabetic retinopathy, while it is an important task in terms of the medical applications, you know, the output is like, how retinopathic are you? It's not like which of 20,000 different categories or 1,000 different categories are here.
Yeah.
So from a machine learning point of view, it's not as interesting of a benchmark. And like most people that design new machine learning techniques don't benchmark them on retinopathy detection. So if you see a result on retinopathy detection, it's not immediately obvious to you whether that's a whole lot better than what people are already doing or not. Like basically, if you want people to just jump out of their seat and say, I agree with you that this is obviously a really good technique for object recognition, then it ought to be benchmarked on ImageNet. Otherwise, if you get the best result on some benchmark that like 3% as many people publish on, we don't really know how to calibrate that. So I think if there were like a really high profile win on ImageNet from using fractional max pooling, then it would take off. But if there's not something like that, then it probably won't.
Yeah, I mean, diabetic retinopathy is a much closer example to the entire domain of medical image computing, which is massively valuable both from a financial and societal point of view. So I think it'd be great if more machine learning researchers did look at benchmarks on this.
Yeah. Yeah, like I said, it's more of a sociology question, like why do we benchmark on ImageNet and not on medical images? And I guess part of it would be the high number of output classes in ImageNet is more relevant to like solving general AI. And for better or worse, a lot of the people designing really cutting edge neural net stuff are usually more interested in solving AI than in solving a particular application. And that sort of influences where our benchmarks and our publishing directions emerge from. Maybe some sociology grad student can study us and tell us why we're doing what we do. But I'm not really qualified to self-analyze in that way.
Question.
Yeah.
Does it make sense to skip downsampling?
Well, it depends whether you need to eventually get a smaller representation or not. So a lot of object recognition architectures, they start with a very big input image, like 256 by 256 by 3. And eventually you might want to get down to like some very small spatial size. Like you might get down to something like a 3x3 grid, and then you have a dense matrix multiply to transform the small number of features on a 3x3 grid to output class probabilities. You don't want to have 256 times 256 times number of channels, different features influencing your final output, because it'll just be way too expensive to parameterize that layer. There are other ways that you can shrink the image size besides downsampling, though. If you don't do any zero padding, your network will automatically shrink. So zero padding is when you add imaginary zeros on the left side of the image. I shouldn't say imaginary because you'll think I mean like complex numbers. You implicitly concatenate zeros under the edge of the image so that the kernel can actually travel so that it extends farther outside the image. When you do this, it makes it so that the output map can be the same size or can even be larger than the input map. If you do not have these implicit zeros on the edge, then the kernel is restricted to traveling within the input map. And so the output map is actually smaller than the input map. So if you don't do any zero padding at all, the output width is equal to the input width minus the kernel width plus 1. And that means every layer will shrink, and there's just a hard limit on how deep your network can be. Because unless you fall back to one by one convolution, you're always going to be shrinking it over there. If you use the zero padding on the sides, you can keep making the network deeper forever because the size always stays the same. Yeah?
Why not use reflection padding or copy padding? Like, is there a concern that the zero padding kind of makes the image think that there are hard edges on the outside?
It's also possible to do the reflection padding and stuff like that. I don't know of any detailed study on which one performs better in which cases.
From the implementation point of view, it will be expensive to copy big images from one side to the other.
It's not super expensive. I mean, the borders are small compared to the whole image. I guess it would depend more on like the performance characteristics of your hardware. If it's going to slow down a lot, have to special case some pixels or not. I don't actually know how expensive it is, but I don't think that expense is really a deal breaker for implementing that kind of feature. But if it gave a big accuracy boost, people would do it a lot more. I'm pretty sure TensorFlow actually supports both of those modes that you mentioned. And as far as I know, they're just not particularly popular to actually use. There might be some place where they're really a killer app that I'm not aware of off the top of my head.
Usually the edge isn't the most important part of the picture anyway.
Yeah. For object recognition anyway. For image generation, it's actually kind of difficult to get a convolutional network to output an image that doesn't look all messed up at the edges, and especially early in training. Usually, after they've trained for a while, they start to learn that the architecture does unusual things at the edges, and they learn how to compensate for it. But at the beginning, when the parameters are randomly initialized, you get an obvious change in brightness near the edge. There's also a few different ways of connecting convolutional layers. So convolution is where you take the same kernel and you apply it everywhere. There's another thing you can do that's sort of intermediate between a fully connected layer and convolution, and that's to use the connectivity pattern of a convolutional layer, but to get rid of the parameter sharing and make it be a little bit more like a fully connected layer. So that's called local convolution, local connections. It's also called unshared convolution sometimes. That terminology was introduced for Theano, I think. So the basic idea is every output pixel will be a function of just a few nearby input pixels, but they'll all have their own parameters. That means that the amount of parameters that you have to store and learn goes up by a lot, but it also means that the function that you learn can be a lot more flexible. These layers are less popular now than they were a while ago. At the time when Quack made the big autoencoder that made the front page of the New York Times, I believe that whole thing was locally connected. And then pretty quickly, people like Christian Zegedy found that it actually wasn't really all that useful to have the independent parameters. And we ended up with things like the Inception Network that were almost entirely convolutional. Another trick that you can use is you can restrict the connectivity between different channels. So far I've described convolution where every output channel looks at every input channel. You can imagine having convolution where some output channels look at only some input channels. So here I've divided the input channels into two groups and the output channels into two groups. And the first group of the output is a function of only the first group of the input. The second group of the output is a function of only the second group of the input. This allows you to have more channels overall without having to have the number of parameters scale quadratically. So it now scales with the group size instead of with the total number of channels. This kind of trick was really popular back in the 90s when convolutional net sizes were very computation constrained. Today it's less popular, but I imagine it might make a comeback at some point if we end up with a better mechanism for learning really big networks. There's also another variant of convolution called tiled convolution. This was popular around like 2010 or so. It's a trade-off between local connection and full convolution. So regular convolution, you use exactly one set of parameters everywhere. So if you have a kernel with two and the different members of the kernel are A and B, then you just repeat A, B, A, B, A, B everywhere. If you have a locally connected layer, then you have different parameters everywhere. So you never actually see the same parameter twice. You have parameters A, B, C, D, E, and so on. And each one appears exactly once in the computation. But if you have tiled convolution, you can come up with as many different sets of parameters as you want, and you just cycle through them as you move across the input. So if we have one set of parameters A and B, and another set of parameters C and D, then we go A, B, C, D, A, B, C, D. So we actually just switch which one we use every time we move to the right. And that that allows you to extract more features without having more memory or more multiply adds involved. You can also get kind of a similar effect by using convolution with stride 2 and feeding in two versions of the input with shifts in the input.
Do you know if anybody's tried using locally connected layers just for the later layers of a convnet?
Well, that's where they were traditionally used the most. Like, I think AlexNet does that. But eventually even that fell out of favor.
Is it okay to just cycle through it like that without shuffling it?
That's the way that people have always done it. And it has fallen out of popularity. I guess the main reason I cover it is so that if you see the term, you know what people are talking about. It's not really an operation that's super useful anymore.
Yeah, in the book you were mentioning also like FuzziNet, where the weights are not one after other, are more sparse to as an input. You were referring to a paper by Lee, 2012, something like that, where it's not a full matrix, it's just selected the points of the matrix, but you learn which points to
Are you talking about probabilistic max pooling, maybe? I'm not quite sure.
No, I was looking at the paper, it's called Fuzzynet.
Do you mean dilation convolutions?
Hmm?
Dilation convolution?
I'm not sure about that.
No. Or
okay.
Actually?
Yeah, I'm not sure. Not sure what you're referring to. So far, I've mostly told you about convolutional networks for object recognition. You can also use convolutional networks for a lot of other activities, like labeling every pixel in an image. So for example, I think Renaud Colabert and his group published a paper a few years ago about actually recognizing every individual pixel in an image using a recurrent architecture like this, where you have hidden units that keep being updated. So you have an input X representing an image, and it influences hidden units that are then used to output labels Y. But this is a whole tensor of labels with one label for every pixel. So some pixels might be assigned to be road, and some pixels might be assigned to be car, for example. But then you can feed those labelings back into the hidden units and get a new estimate of what the hidden units look like based on your most recent estimate of how the classes are distributed. And after a few steps of this, you get a really nice cleaned up map of where all the objects should be, because these hidden unit interactions with the labels can learn things that, for example, objects tend to appear in, you know, solid regions that you don't have. Like alternating road car pixels, you tend to have, you know, like 20 car pixels in a row followed by 5 road pixels in a row. And I guess the most important thing to get from this slide is just that the output can actually be a whole tensor, where it's you know, a different value for every pixel. The output doesn't need to be an object category.
What happens if in X a lot of the points were missing?
Then you would need to do something like encode whether points are present or absent. That case isn't studied a whole lot for convolutional networks, or, well, really for deep learning in general. Our community just doesn't really deal with the missing value problem all that well. The main work that I know of dealing with missing values is a paper I wrote myself in grad school for a model called multi-prediction deep pulsing machines. And the main point of the paper was not classification with missing inputs, but it essentially had an architecture that looked a lot like this, with the recurrent incremental updating. And in addition to passing in the input X, you also said which values in X were present or absent. And on each recurrent update step, it would fill in the missing values. And just over time, you get a better guess of what those missing values should look like. That's not done as much now, because 4 years ago when I wrote that paper, most deep models were things like Boltzmann machines, where it was very easy to have missing variables. And the newer probabilistic models work better than Boltzmann machines if you have completely observed variables, but they don't deal very cleanly with missing variables. At least not yet.
Is there a reason why the arrows do not go directly from H1 to H2, for instance?
You could also have those arrows. There's not really any reason why you wouldn't.
And then why would it use rectified linear units if you go to... So what kind of nonlinearity you would use?
You could use any kind of nonlinearity with this architecture. The nonlinearity wouldn't matter a whole lot. If you use something like hyperbolic tangent, you'd be less likely to get an explosion problem. But you could probably get even rectified linear units to work with careful tuning of the hyperparameters, especially if your recurrent depth was not too big. So convolutional networks are one of the places where there's the clearest correspondence between deep learning and neuroscience. A lot of the time you hear people describing deep learning as resembling the brain in some way, but really the resemblances are very vague and qualitative. It's not like deep learning models are specifically a model of the way that the brain actually functions. But for convolutional networks, you can actually find some very close similarities between the brain and what convolutional networks learn. One thing that's really interesting is that we actually know more or less what the first few layers of the brain are learning. I guess there's some caveats to that statement, but for the neurons that we understand in the first few layers of the brain, we know that they're learning little edge detectors like this. These are called Gabor functions. So a Gabor function says that there's a Gaussian window where the neuron responds to input that lies within that Gaussian. And then there's a sinusoidal wave that says whether the neuron is excited or inhibited by light at different regions. So if the window is wide compared to the period of that sinusoid, you can actually start to see more than two regions of darkness. Or if it's small relative to the sinusoid, you might see only one. But basically, all of these are different widths and positions of the Gaussian envelope that shows where the neuron will respond, and different angles and frequencies of the sinusoid that determines how it responds. They're all essentially little edge detectors. And it turns out that if you take these formulas that describe what we believe neurons learn, and you compare them to what actual convolutional networks learn in the first layer, you can see really a lot of similarities. Different learning algorithms will learn different functions. The one on the left is a sparse coding algorithm, and the one on the right is a supervised classification convolutional network. So they obviously learn slightly different things. But they're both similar to Gabor functions with different kinds of parameters for the Gaussian envelope and also for the sinusoid. There's other correspondences between convolutional networks and deep learning. It's actually possible to use convolutional networks to predict the firing rates of neurons in the brain, or to use firing rates in the brain to predict the activation values of convolutional network features, at least in the visual region of the brain when applied to images. But we're still pretty far from fully understanding what the brain does. One complication is that when you first look at an image, you initially have a feed-forward pass where you have several different layers to your brain, and one layer is activated by the previous layer in a chain, a lot like the way that a convolutional network is activated. But after the first few milliseconds, those layers start to update their activation value based on feedback connections and also due to lateral connections between neighboring units. And if you actually look at an image for longer, then several updates coming from these backwards and sideways connections start to change the activations that your neurons have. And our modern convolutional networks are not yet very good at predicting the final outcome of our neural activations after they've had some time to do these iterative updates. And those updates might be a lot of what makes us a lot smarter than a modern convolutional network. It's really hard to keep up to date with all the different architectures of convolutional networks. And if I told you what the best convolutional network architecture is today, I'd probably accidentally tell you something that's 2 weeks out of date. And even if I actually was up to date, it would be out of date 2 weeks from now. So I won't attempt to do that. But I should try to tell you there's like a few major families of networks out there. One of them that's pretty old is the spatial transducer net. It's a convolutional network that's just convolutional on every layer. And so the size of the output scales with the size of the input. So it allows you to kind of take a sequence of inputs and get a sequence of outputs. That's a really important family of convolutional network architectures that's not going away. The other architectures in here are usually used as many input, single output networks. You show them an image with lots of pixels, and you get a single class identity up at the end. So really influential architecture from a few years ago is the all-convolutional net. It doesn't have any pooling. It just has convolution with strides greater than one occasionally to shrink the size of the representation. And that's gone on to influence a lot of subsequent architectures. There's the inception network. It's a very complicated architecture where the main thing you need to understand about it is that it was designed to minimize the number of multiplies and adds that you need to do in order to get a good recognition. A lot of the time you hear about new models getting really good recognition accuracy, but then you look into the details and you see that the model is also just gigantic. So a lot of the time when people get improved object recognition performance, it's just because a newer model of GPU came out and they were able to throw more resources at it than the previous authors the year before. Inception was designed to try to get around that particular trend and really get something efficient. And I'm not even going to attempt to explain what all the architectural features of it are. Another one that's really important and really popular the last few months is residual networks, or ResNets for short. The idea is instead of having a big chain of layers where each layer completely replaces the activations of the previous layers or the new set of activations, you have layers that add their activations to an earlier set of activations. So you can think of each layer as adding a diff, essentially, where you take one input and you keep just adding diffs to it until it's been transformed into something a lot better. The reason that ResNets are really important is that the gradient with respect to the final layer actually just has an identity connection all the way back to the first layer that you started adding diffs to. So it's really easy to backpropagate that gradient through and figure out how the original layer ought to be updated. It gets around the vanishing gradient problem that traditional deep architectures had. And so like batch norm, it makes it really easy to train some architectures that were hard to train before. We can train just absurdly deep architectures now. Yeah.
With the kind of loss of pooling layers, you talk in the book a lot about how pooling layers give us the ability to use varying size images. What are the best techniques to deal with varying size images with these newer architectures?
That's not studied as much lately. People recently have mostly been concerned with processing fixed size images. And a lot of the time you'll see things that seem like they should be really silly, like just taking an image and resampling it to fit the same fixed size input to some object recognition network, and it often works just fine.
Are you aware of any encouraging lines of inquiry that are current or past ones which haven't really been followed up on?
Well, yeah, I don't really know of any particular analogy between variable size pooling and anything that you could do with an all convolutional net. I mean, the analogous way of transforming the all convolutional net would be to resize its kernel. And that wouldn't make a whole lot of sense unless maybe you, you could do things like just upsampling the kernel, but it would change its semantics so much that I doubt it would work very well. I guess the history of deep learning is full of statements like that that ended up being totally wrong. So I should always be careful when I say that things would obviously not work well. But I don't see a way that the all convolutional net could be adapted in a straightforward way to mimic the way that variable size pooling used to work. Yeah.
ResNet sounds an awful lot like your description of the early visual system updating activation.
Yeah, that's true. There's a lot of things that are similar to the early visual system. So you could also get interactions between neighboring units by having recurrent networks that process each of your activation maps instead of having convolutional networks. Those would, if you had each unit connected to its neighboring units, and then you just ran like bidirectional recurrence for a while, that would give you a similar effect. The thought has crossed my mind that ResNets might be doing something like taking a single layer of the visual system and running it for many time steps. And then you can imagine, I think there's a paper called like residual nets in residual nets, where that's doing something kind of like having multiple layers of the cortical hierarchy, each updated for multiple time steps.
The feedback connections in the brain that you mentioned, what do you think they're correcting for? Because over here, what it's backpropagating is the error derivative from the during training, right? So, but in you mentioned that when we're looking at an image, the longer we look at it, the more updates that are made in the feedback.
So I should be careful when talking about neuroscience because my neuroscience credentials are not that great. I did actually study neuroscience in undergrad for a while before I switched to machine learning, and there was this popular factoid in a lot of my textbooks that said that there are 10 times more neurons going backwards than forwards. If that's true, and it's not just one of those things like Albert Einstein said we only use 10% of our brain's potential, then that would suggest that like maybe some of those backwards connections could be used for something resembling backprop, and maybe the others are used for things resembling mean field inference in a Boltzmann machine. So there's a lot of graphical models where you have random variables representing different degrees of abstraction. So the lower layers are variables like, is there an edge at this particular pixel or not? And the higher level variables are like, am I looking at a picture of a dog or not? And there's a lot of examples where if you know the higher level information, it might change what you think about the lower level information. So there's some neuroscience experiments that suggest that even the very first, like the V1 cortex, is aware of whether a particular input position is part of the foreground or the background. And that seems like it has to be coming from the top down. So if the top down information tells you you're a foreground pixel, you're some of the fur on the dog, then it might convey more precise information than if it's told you're a background pixel, and it could just sort of say like, okay, I'm chilling out and not sending as much information because I don't matter as much. So
what do you mean top down?
So top down is when a feature that's more removed from the input sends information back to a feature that was originally calculated very close to the input. So like, say that we have an input image here, which is drop pixels. And let's say that there's a face, and my chalkboard drawing ability is not great. Now let's say that this face is in shadow. This is kind of a classic example. So the left half of the face is really dark. And the edges from things like the mouth are not particularly pronounced because the left half of the face is so dark. So the contrast in that part of the image is not this bright. So now let's say that we have a bunch of V1 units that are detecting edges in the image. Well, on the right side of the image where it's bright, it might be really lit up. On the left side of the image where it's dark, it might be responding very faintly, where they're saying like, maybe there's an edge here, but I still think it's very low probability. Then you extract higher level features that use these edges. And I'll skip a bunch of steps, but eventually you get something like in LGN saying, you know, there's a face here. And this information can then be fed back to the lower layers. So
do we do that in any CNN architectures, or is this just a conceptual?
We haven't yet made this have a big payoff. So if you have a review for a conference, every year you'll see somebody saying, we really ought to have feedback connections and deep neural networks. And as a reviewer, you say, I know. everybody has tried this. But it has not yet resulted in a really big payoff in terms of object recognition performance being better. The main thing where it actually is important is if you want to assign an output label to every pixel. And then it's really helpful for coordinating all the output labels so that they actually appear in contiguous blocks. So like if you want to just
example of a paper that did that?
Well, there's if you read the book, there's a reference to one on recurrent scene labeling. That's one of the main examples. There's a few different groups that have done that.
This is prediction, right? The ResNets are bearing weights, isn't that different? It's saying, I mean, you can't.
No, ResNets have an architecture where they update the values, essentially. It's not a learning algorithm. So to complete this example here, after you have the top-down information that there's a face in this image, these units here could update their confidence that they're actually supposed to be activated by quite a lot. That they say, oh, well, I don't see a very strong edge here, but I know that there's a face in this location. And so the faint edge that I see here is consistent with the mouth or the side of the face that I expected to see. And so they activate more strongly. So things like deep Boltzmann machines show this property, but deep Boltzmann machines have not really scaled up very well to really large images. For a while, they were state-of-the-art in very small handwriting recognition tasks. Yeah?
I think there's sort of two aspects of that. One is the lower levels of neural nets generally learn very slowly, I mean, in humans anyway. because, for example, when I was in graduate school, I was doing the voice recognition type stuff, and I had this advisor who was Czechoslovakian, and he says, well, can you tell the difference between ah and ah? And I listened very carefully, and actually what I heard sounded identical. He says, well, he says in the Czech language, these have two totally different sounds. He says, but you'll never learn the difference. And so there seems to be something we learn very early that never changes. And I'm just wondering if this platform is something that when we could train a platform of that's at some very low level, and then just use that platform thereon, and not as a platform for say all kinds of different languages, whatever. And that would pretty much be static for, well, say, for a given language.
Yeah, that's a pretty common universal engineering strategy, is to share the same features across multiple tasks and not relearn them all the time. And there's a lot of libraries where you can just download pre-trained ImageNet features and then use them as input to whatever kind of vision task you want to do yourself. And then it makes more sense to share the lower ones.
So this particular thing you're talking about over here is a little different. You're just essentially...
Well, this isn't learning. This is inference.
Okay, just sort of...
So this is what happens when your synapses are already set, mm-hmm. and you're looking at a single image. What you're talking about is how your synapses change over time to respond to different features of the input. And it's hard from a machine learning point of view to say very much about why we don't learn many different phonemes after we're a year old or so.
Yeah.
Now that might be something to do with the dynamics of gradient descent. That might be something to do with whether we're using reinforcement learning or supervised learning or unsupervised learning. It could be that we don't learn phonemes. We don't learn the differences between phonemes, but there's no reward signal based on how the people in our environment respond to the different phonemes. So, you're only listening to people speaking English, you're not going to get a social reward for being able to tell apart Polish phonemes. So maybe that's why. Or it could also be that if you're in an environment where everybody's speaking English, that even if there weren't a social reward factor, you're just not exposed to the Polish phonemes. So even unsupervised learning wouldn't learn to separate them. I actually don't really know how much each of those factors goes into explaining that particular issue.
Plus, there are people who have learned other languages later in life, so it's not completely impossible to
have
the brain with additional data.
I also heard from somebody once, I don't know how true this is, but a neuroscience student at Stanford told me once that you can learn new phonemes faster if you're subjected to electrical shocks, which is a phoneme discrimination question wrong. So that would suggest the reinforcement.
Try that on me.
Deep Narayan Singh, sorry if I mispronounced that, asks, when we say f of x plus x in the ResNet architecture, how do we ensure that the dimension of the f of x and x is the same?
So you have to use convolution stride of 1, and you have to use the right amount of zero padding to make sure that the size of the architecture doesn't change.
I have a slightly strange question. In convolutional neural networks, we use relus, right? And in recurrent networks, we usually use gated units for some very good deep reasons. Why not the other way around?
You can. I think there's a paper called Highway Networks that does that. Some of these things are just cultural.
Okay.
Yeah.
Could you discuss the role of pre-processing the image before you send it into the convolutional neural network?
Yeah, so a few years ago, it used to be really important to do lots of fancy pre-processing. Like widening and stuff like that. Oh, and by the way, this is the last slide, so I'm just answering questions now. So a few years ago, pre-processing used to be really important. Now you basically just subtract the mean from the image, and that's about it. There might be some application domains that need more pre-processing, but modern convolutional networks can pretty much figure things out on their own.
Fred Keybox asks, what suggestion do you have to detect small objects in a large field? Just manually move the net's input multiple times, or use offset kernels stacked high?
You could do things like have really big max pooling regions. Like have something like a spatial transducer net that will output a map of whether it thinks the image is object, whether the object is absent or present at every point of the image, and then just put a big global max pooling unit on top of that.
Does fast Fourier transform make sense to speed up convolutions, or?
I'm not as sure about that. Yeah, I haven't kept up to date with the latest developments. I think it's something like if the kernel size is sufficiently large, then it's useful. But from my point of view, the convolution implementation is just a black box that I make use of other people's work on. I guess someone like Scott Gray could probably tell you what the best algorithm is for every size of kernel, but I don't actually remember where each algorithm is most competitive. Yeah.
The second, any NLP applications that jump to mind that are state of the art, because this is mostly about the image processing.
So the question is whether there's any NLP applications of convolutional nets that are state of the art. I don't follow NLP as closely as I follow vision. My understanding is that the state of the art in NLP is all recurrent networks right now, rather than convolutional networks.
Yeah, I like have read a little bit of that. I don't know if it's still state of the art, but people were using quantum nets, especially generative connections of quantum nets, I think, to generate sequences of characters. And the exploring the limits of language modeling. It's been a while since I read it, but I think it used that. I was also going to ask, do you know of any place where there's like a wiki or anything like that where people are tracking state-of-the-art from via ArcSiv firehose?
So Rodrigo Benenson has a website that's called like Are We There Yet or something yet? But I'm not sure if that's still updated regularly. I
don't think it is.
Yeah, I think that he got overwhelmed by the archive firehose. It's possible that OpenAI might attempt to provide a benchmarking tracking service in the future, but we're not ready to commit to that officially yet. And even if we do promise to do it, it's not something we'll do like next week or anything.
That would be exciting.
Yeah.
GANs seem to work great on text, words, flowers, bedrooms-ish. ImageNet seems to be, there's a larger jump in difficulty, it seems like, in generating convincing ImageNet images. I'm just wondering what you...
The difficulty is when the output has a lot of diversity. So when the input tells you more or less what the output should be, let's see, I should have a presentation about GANs in here somewhere.
With the input, you mean like the conditioning information, like the class label or something?
Yeah, so like Scott Reed's paper on text to image synthesis. So if this isn't too slow here. So here's some slides on generative adversarial nets. So here we have a sentence that says, this white and yellow flower have thin white petals and a round yellow stamen. So the GAN was actually friendly and didn't correct their grammar, but instead made all these white flowers. So these flowers all look more or less the same as each other. Mm-hmm. And we accept that as okay, because it matches with the sentence. But
it seems to always have one orientation that refers to that flower.
Yeah. And so like here, this impresses us because it successfully accomplished the task of turning the sentence into the flower picture. But it has not really learned about the full diversity of white flowers that there could be in the world. Now imagine that for ImageNet, it learned to only make one image. We would not be very happy about that. Instead, it learns to make many images, but there aren't that many of them that are all that great. Basically, I think the trick is being able to get lots of outputs that are good for a particular input. And for things like just generating ImageNet with no input, then there's really only one input, which is the null input.
Do the captions help, you think?
Yeah, I think the captions do help. I guess I don't know for sure. I haven't actually trained this particular task myself. But it fits my general pattern of thinking that things are easier when the diversity of the output is small. So for example, here's CIFAR 10. There's 10 different classes, and you can see quite a lot of them. You know, like there's a car, that's a pretty good car. There's a horse, that's a pretty good horse. There's a boat, it's a pretty good boat. There's a truck. The back end of it is kind of fading, but it's a pretty good truck. So like CIFAR 10, we generate some stuff where it's like, what's that, like a cloud or something? That's not actually one of the 10 classes. But probably at least like half of the things we generate are recognizably one of the classes, because there's really only 10 of them. But then ImageNet, when there's 1,000 classes, most things we get are just kind of like modern art or like, you know, Hieronymus Bosch style nightmare things. And yeah, we do occasionally get things that actually have like heads and legs and all. But when there's 1,000 classes, it's really hard for it to learn like this is a person's shape and it should only ever have person clothes and skin. And like this is cow skin and it should only ever appear on something with four legs. And you know, just the more different categories of things it has to make, the harder it is.
Those are pretty impressive failures. That's an impressive confusion to make.
Well, thank you. Right. Yeah, I prefer impressive success than successive failure. Yeah.
It seems to make some really hard decisions about the foreground background though.
Yeah, and the background tends not to be 3D at all. And a lot of the time the foreground isn't 3D either.
Are there any approaches to handling video that you think are kind of likely to work out well?
I haven't spent a lot of time thinking about video. My only video modeling work was like a relatively contrived setup where there was a fixed camera, so the background doesn't move, and we were able to generate videos just by moving individual pixels around. But in terms of the more general video scenario, I don't really have any great ideas off the top of my head. Facebook AI research has done some work on that, combining an adversarial loss and a few other tricks. And so has William Lauder, also combining adversarial loss and a few other tricks.
I was thinking more of recognition than generation.
Oh, I see. Well, recognition, I think it's more we're just waiting for the data set. I guess I don't know what recognition data sets are out there, but a few years ago, people were publishing all these results on, I think it's like the KTH data set, which is like pictures of a man punching in a field. And I think it's like the same guy for every video clip. And there's not that many of them. Or like in grad school, I was working on action recognition for the Hollywood action recognition data set, where they have clips from like, it's on the order of 1,000 clips from just commercial movies, and there's not nearly enough of them to really learn what's going on. The diversity in them is insane. Like one of the actions you're meant to recognize is get out of car. One of the clips is from some like gangster movie where a car drives around a corner really fast and they throw a body rolled up in a sheet out the window. And you're supposed to look at that and say, get out of car. And you're not going to learn that amount of generalizability from the order of 1,000 examples. It's possible that there's a much bigger video recognition data set that I'm not aware of now, but at least for public research outside of companies that have their own video labeled data sets, the main bottleneck right now is just not having enough labeled data.
In the book you mentioned time series data as possible application for convolutional networks. Are there good papers on anything that's non-image data, but good example could use with?
Well, so the very first convolutional networks were called time delay neural networks, and those were applied to sequence tasks. So that would be probably the like most historically interesting paper there. And then I guess you were saying that Rafal's latest paper on language modeling uses convolution rather than LSTMs, or did I understand you correctly?
The exploring the limits of language model.
Exploring the limits of language model. Okay. Yeah. And DeepMind has a new paper about speech generation using a special kind of convolutional network. And if I remember correctly, there's no recurrence in there. So that would be purely a convolutional network. That's called WaveNet.
So if I move the problem from a spatial domain to a frequency domain, do you think we'll need less convolutional kinds of layers?
Oh, I'm not really sure. I mean, that conversion works like once, but then it's harder to think about when there's multiple layers and things like that. For audio processing, people often convert to a spectrogram and then just treat it as an image. And that works pretty well for them. So I guess that works in that case. The conversion is only once, though. It's not at every layer of the content. I'm actually not really sure what that would mean to do it more than one layer. All right, well, should we call it an evening then?
Sounds good to me.
Thank you.